Hello everyone and welcome to Talks at Google. My name is Gautami and I'm a customer engineer with Google Cloud Platforms based in New York City. And because of the current situation, I'm dialing in from my home sweet home. For everyone celebrating Diwali this month, happy Diwali to you and your loved ones. May this and all the coming years bring joy and happiness to you and your family. I'm super excited to welcome our guest for today, Ahana Kumra. Hi, Ahana.
Hi, Gautami, and happy Diwali to you.
Happy Diwali. I'm sure everyone knows her already, but she's very, very well known for her work in film, television, and theater. She has shared screen with the legendary actors Amitabh Bachchan, Nasiruddin Shah, Makarand Deshpande, and a lot more. She has starred in various Bollywood films, TV serials, and a lot of web series, which has streamed on Netflix, Amazon Prime, YouTube, and many more. She is very well known and also most appreciated for her bold character she has played on screen. And she has influenced a lot of women by doing so. The quality, which I'm very proud of, is in spite of these several accolades, she continues to be humble and down to earth. I'm very excited to welcome you to Talks at Google. Welcome, Ahana.
Thanks, Gautami. That's such a sweet introduction.
So, first question, how was Diwali? Did you have fun?
It was actually quite normal. It was very usual. I don't usually go out on Diwali. I always celebrate it at home with my parents. And my sister and my nephew and my brother-in-law come over. And I really have a very intimate, sweet sort of a dinner we plan. And we light up the entire house. We do rangoli. So we do a lot of decorations. And every year I send out a lot of hampers to everybody. So this year wasn't any different for me. So whether it was COVID or non-COVID, Diwali didn't really matter to me. So it was quite a usual Diwali scenario at home.
So true. Absolutely. And for those who are watching, can you tell us what Diwali is all about and why do we celebrate it?
Diwali is a festival of lights. It's celebrated in India. It is after Ramji came back from his Vanvas, a 14 years exile. And that's why it's the festival of lights. It's the festival of joy. It's the festival of giving. I think the one thing that really matters for me, and I know everybody around me, is that everybody exchanges mithais, which is sweets. You know, we light up our houses, we do, you know, rangolis, we light up the diyas, you know, the earthen diyas that we light up in our houses. And I'm sure Gautami must be missing that because she's been away from home this year. And there are lots of sweets that get made, namely something like, there's this one particular sweet called gujia that gets made during Diwali. And I know, Gautami, your mouth is watering.
I know.
Chakli and gujia, because these are like the sweets that, you know, that get made at home. Then there is some yummy food from, you can say, like, you know, there can be like chole bature, which is like, yeah, okay, I can see Gautami. There's matar paneer, there is, you know, pulao, like vegetable pulao or things like that. There's like a proper feast at home. The entire family comes over. It could be, you could compare it to something like a Christmas. It could be an equivalent to a Christmas in, you know, abroad or a Thanksgiving dinner, something like that. But of course, it's very high on calories. It's very heavy on sweets. There's a lot of almonds and cashew nuts and the work that goes into Diwali. So Diwali is actually, I think, one festival that most Indians I know look forward to. In India, we've been trying to actually speak against bursting of crackers. But that's what we do. We burst a lot of crackers and we burst a lot of, like, you know, we spark, like, a lot of sparklers and everything gets, you know, lit during Diwali. But this time, like, I think Bombay has behaved itself a lot. Mumbai has recorded the lowest number of noise pollution and air pollution as compared to the other cities in all of India. So I'm very, very proud of my city and I'm very happy that, you know, people have really behaved themselves during COVID.
Yeah, absolutely. That was a lovely, you know, way of defining Diwali. Like, I never thought of it that way in terms of Thanksgiving and Christmas, right? That's amazing. So, today the topic of discussion for us is new age superheroines. So we are going to learn more about Ahana's journey, her roles, how the roles portrayed in film industry are changing and challenging those stereotypes and more. So with that, tell us more about your journey of acting, where it started and when did you decide that this is what you want to do?
So for all those who don't know, Gautami and I have known each other since she was very little. She was perhaps 10 when I met her first, and I must have been 16. We were in the same dance classes, and there's a very famous dance class in Bombay. It's called Shamak Davar's dance school. And everybody usually joins that for the summer funk or like the summer workshops. You may say it's like, the summer vacations. And most kids in Bombay join those classes. That's where Gautami and I met years ago, and we've all stayed in touch, and we've remained friends through. I've become an actor. Now she works at Google, and I'm immensely proud of what she's become. And it's lovely that she stays in touch. So I'm going to start from the beginning. I was born and brought up in a city called Lucknow, which is a state called Uttar Pradesh in India. And my mother is a police officer. She has worked in the police force for 34 years. She worked with the CBI, now in Bombay. And my father is in pharmaceuticals, and he took care of he was currently the vice president, and before retiring, he was the vice president at a company called Lupin Laboratories, and he used to stay in Russia. So my parents were literally having a long distance relationship for a very long time. My mother had to handle three children all by herself, three hooligans, I must say, and it was not easy. So then we decided to move to Bombay because that was the one city that my father used to visit very often, and not Lucknow so much. So we decided to move to one city and make that the hub. We moved to Bombay, and that's where my love for cinema actually began, because in Lucknow I was not allowed to watch TV. I didn't have a cable TV. The only films I ever watched were Disney animation films, and most of the films that I watched were Mr. Amitabh Bachchan's films, because those are the only films I had VCR. We used to have the VCRs and the cassettes, so I used to watch all of those. So he has really like influenced a lot of my growing up years. And when I moved to Bombay, I remember the first time during the summer vacation I joined Prithvi Theatre. And Prithvi Theatre has this thing called Summertime Workshop, which has a lot of children enrolling into a workshop, during their summer vacations. And that's when I joined the Shamak as well. So basically, I had too much energy. I was like, I have to do this, I have to do that. Let me join something so that I can come back home and just go off to sleep. So I was really like, so I joined a theatre workshop, and I joined a dance workshop. And both of them I enjoyed thoroughly. And I think my mother somewhere knew deep down that I wanted to become an actor, because this is something I absolutely truly enjoyed. But obviously I was running helter skelter. I had no idea what I wanted to do with my life. So I completed my graduation. I studied advertising. I worked in an ad agency, after which I quit. And my mother just sat me down one day and she was like, "What do you want to do?" And I was like, "I don't know. I'm not sure. Maybe I don't know." She's like, "Do you want to be an actor?" And I said, "I don't know if I should tell you this, because I'm not sure if this is an answer. Two people who are not from the film industry will understand. And I know lots of girls who are not from the film business in India. It's difficult for them to even get this message across to their parents that you want to work in the film business, you want to work in the film industry, you want to be an actor. So I thought my parents will not understand, or my mother will not get it. And I give her a lot of credit, because she was the one who enrolled me into a film school, and she said, "Go to a film school because you need education and we cannot educate you." So that's what happened, and I went to a film school and I studied filmmaking for 2 years, after which I graduated from film school. And then I started doing odd jobs in production houses. I started working as an assistant director, assistant production, production assistant, casting assistant. I think I've done all assistant jobs before I kind of figured out what is it that how do I go about in the Hindi film industry. So opportunities were very ra less. They were rare when I started out. There was more work in television, less work in films. Not too many roles written for women, which still is a problem in films primarily. But I think with the onset of OTT, that's web platforms, we started getting a lot of work. So that's how my introduction to cinema happened, when I went to film school, before which Prithvi Theatre was a very integral part of my being, and it still is. So all those who don't know, Prithvi Theatre is a theatre in Bombay, which is in a place called Juhu. And I think every actor who has ever begun their journey has begun it from Prithvi Theatre. That's the stage that we all worship.
Yeah, and Prithvi Cafe has yummy food as well.
We're dreaming of a lot of food tonight.
Because you started talking about food, now I am thinking of chole bhatures. Oh, awesome. So your first, like, you know, break, I would call it, was playing Leela from Lipstick Under My Burkha. So tell us about that, like, you know, in the sense that how did you feel like portraying that? Was that film was all about women, so tell us more about playing that character and how it changed your experience or even your entry in Bollywood.
So this is very interesting. I had done just before that, I had done a show that was my debut show with Mr. Bachchan. Amitabh Bachchan is a legendary actor in India. He's a mega star in India. I shared my on-screen, I was his on-screen daughter. My first stint in front of camera was to do a scene with him. And, you know, so that was in, I think 2012 is when I did this show with him. And we went on filming till 2013 or something. And I literally worked with him for a year. For me, like, it was my greatest break, you know, like, it was like, there's nothing beyond Mr. Bachchan's, you know, like, I saw the way he used to conduct himself on set, the way he was so punctual, the way he used to be with his co-actors, with his colleagues, with everybody else around him. He used to keep a very jovial environment. So I learned a lot from him. And coincidentally, I was offered a Lipstick Under My Burkha, I think in March, and I was still filming for Yudh, and I had to turn down the film because I could not give away the same dates. Like, there was a major date clash happening. They wanted me to go to Bhopal and shoot, and I was shooting for Yudh in Bombay. So I had to turn down the film. And coincidentally, I got a call once the show, once the film I turned down. I felt very bad about it because I thought it was a script I had never read. It was a role that was never offered to me. And it was a role that I don't think I would have ever been offered in my entire life. So I remember, like, feeling extremely bad about it. And then I think in August or something, I got a call from two casting directors who are friends. And they were like, you know, there's a film happening and this is the story. And I was like, hey, I've read the script. I know this. So they were like, would you like to test for it? I said, yeah, I'd love to. Like, you know, I thought this film was made. They were like, no, there was some delays and they haven't still found the actors and, you know, and everything else. And I was just like, okay, I'll audition. And I remember going for the audition and I got the part and I was like, I can't believe this. Like, it's just luck that, you know, something that I didn't or couldn't do in March, I've managed to, you know, crack the audition in August. So that happened and it turned out very well. We started filming for Lipstick. So those who don't know, Lipstick Under My Burkha is a very, was a sleeper hit of 2017. It's a story about four women in a small town in India called Bhopal. This film has traveled to about 17, 18 big international festivals all across the world, and it has won awards everywhere. The film is about four women. One is in her 20s, one is in her 30s, one is in her 40s, and one is about 50s. And, you know, and their little, how do I say, you know, they used to have like these rebellions, small rebellions that women can continue doing in their day-to-day life, because in India, we live very closed lives, you know, we have like literally dual lives for women. So you may be somebody else in front of the society, but you are somebody else when you are alone in your private space. So the film is about four women and it's a beautiful film. All those who haven't watched it, please watch it. It really is my favorite film. I've seen it about 22 times. And you won't believe, like, I traveled with that film to about all of the US. I remember when the film was banned in India. And I remember when I was in Los Angeles with my director, it was playing at the IFLA. And it was the opening, it was a closing film at the IFLA. That's the International Film Festival of Los Angeles. And the Indian Film Festival of Los Angeles. I remember it was, that's when the news broke out. And Alankrita, who's my director, she and I were sitting in the room and then suddenly we heard the news that the film Lipstick Under My Burkha has been banned in India. And we were like, what do you mean it's banned? And then there was like this long letter that came out saying that it has sexual noises and something, something, something. And the censor board just gave us like the most bizarre reasons for banning the film. And I was like, what do you mean banned? Like, I'd never heard of these things. That it was very unheard of that they've, it's not even like it's censored. The film is banned in India. It cannot release in India. So then I remember like, I went around all the countries, all the cities in the US, watched the film so many times. It was because now it became a banned film in India. It became even more like, what is it about this film that needs to be banned? So I remember like watching it like at every festival with packed audiences, packed. Like I've never seen such numbers in my life for a film's opening. Wow. And it was fantastic. Yeah. And the women would like sit in like, you know, women would sit in clusters and watch it. And like, you know, they'd watch the scenes and they'd be like, yeah, this has happened to us. Yeah, this has happened to us. And I'm just like, it's so bizarre. They can relate to it. It was, okay, the most bizarre thing that happened with that film was that I remember the premiere of that film. I watched that film for the first time in my life in Tokyo. I remember Alankrita meeting me 2 years after the film was shot. We had not heard from Alankrita. We didn't know what was happening with the film because it was a small independent film. We don't sometimes know what the future of these films in India is. Right. And I remember Alankrita coming to me and she was like, the film is premiering in Tokyo. Let's go. I was like, it's not like Lonavala. I have to go to Tokyo. Like, no, we have to get the ball rolling, you know, the film has to release and we have to fight the battle ourselves and it's the onus is on us and, you know, all those things. And I was like, okay, so let's go to Tokyo. And I remember watching the film with a Japanese audience for the first time in my life. And the Japanese audience is very different from an Indian audience, you know, like in India, like, you know, we go like, ha, 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 for everything.
Correct.
The Japanese would just like go, hit this chuckle. You're sitting in an audience with like 300, 400 people and they're just chuckling. So I'm just like, I'm very confused. I don't know whether they're liking the film.
Funny or no.
Yeah, I don't know. So for me, the film had hit the ball out of the park. Like I was just like, what is this film? Like I watched it and I remember like hugging Alankrita and I was like, what have you made? Like, this is outstanding. I didn't have words after the film. I think I was very numb. Like, I just didn't know what to say. Because for me, it was a very hard-hitting film. And so the Japanese audience is very sweet. Like, they come and they take, like, your autographs. Very sweetly, they come and, like, you know, they come and take your autographs. So they stand in a line for that. So the film got over. And then we all were standing outside. And all the Japanese women were coming to us. And they were, like, you know, taking our autographs and... And there's this one lady, I remember, she came and she just hugged Alankrita and she started crying. And there was a translator standing next to us. And she just said, how did you know our story? And, you know, that was such a slap on my face because I was just like, what do you mean? How do you know our story? And she's like, this happens in Japan also. And I think for me, the film became very real when I started traveling with the film to all the festivals in different countries.
Because and how different people,
And I realized that the story of women all across the globe is the same, whether you are in India or you are sitting in America or you could be in Tokyo or you could be in Australia. It doesn't matter because I traveled with the film to all these countries and the reaction was the same. It was just the same. So we really like did fight a lot for the film. The film finally released in India to packed theaters and it was a small, I think, 4 crore film, which made about 22 crores. Business in India. And for me, that has been a life-changing experience. Life-changing.
Yeah. And if you guys haven't watched it, you have to watch it. You're definitely missing out on something. It's an amazing film and Ahana has done a brilliant job. So where actresses, you know, tend to choose more glamorous role, you chose to play Alu, a woman with a mysterious face scarf in your recent Netflix series, Betal. You have inspired so many women to be confident in their own skin and also shift perception on how society looks at them. Can you share more experience about portraying this character and have women come up to you and kind of said that, you know, we relate to this or just playing this character?
And that's actually quite a favorite picture of mine, actually. That was a picture I took. We were filming in Yashraj Studios in Bombay. And I remember that there was a bomb blast that we had done. And immediately after the bomb blast, I came running to my room to take a continuity still of my face, because sometimes I just keep it for my own records. Right. And I saw my face and I was like, oh my God, is this what I look like? So lots of times this happens. So I have played this character called Alu Alia, which is in a series called Betal. It's a Netflix series. And it was filmed last year and it came out this year. The film is about, this is a series, it's a four-part series, a four-episode series on zombies versus humans, for the first time in India. I would not like to only call them zombies, I'd like to call them pretas, because in India we Betal is such a, so my director, his name's Patrick Graham, he is British, and he's made a series called Ghoul just before that. So he's all into, he's all into horror and he's all into, gruesome things. So sometimes I always like joke about these things. Like, are these people like living with you? Because you always make series which are like that. When Betal was offered to me, I remember, he told me that I'll be having a scar on my face. And I said, what do you mean? He's like, no, she's had a past, there's been a history where, she's been through some sort of an acid attack, and of course we had to build a backstory for ourselves, but that was not part of the series. But I remember the first time when I wore prosthetics, so it used to take me about 1.5 hours in the morning to wear prosthetics, on my face. And I remember walking out of my vanity on the first day. We were shooting in this place called Lonavala, which is a hill station from Bombay. It's about 2 hours away. And I remember walking out and everybody has stopped. And, they just stared at me like this. And I was so embarrassed. I was like, oh my God. Like, I'm so like, why do I hide my face? What do I do, So I was like, I'm walking like this because I was so... I'm just not used to having anybody stare at me like that. So that gaze was so different from any other gaze I've had, because actresses and women are so used to everybody looking at you. Like when you walk out of the vanity, like everything is like hair flying. You look so glamorous, whatever. But this is the first time I was having people stare at me for, having a scar on my face. And I realized how difficult it must be for someone to live like that, all their lives, who've been scarred. And that really made me feel different. And I think that is when, for me, like my character became absolutely alive to me. So there are lots of times I think we actors have to have empathy for the characters that we play. And I'm very grateful that, a lot of makers come to me with very different parts. They're not the usual, let's be glamorous, let's look beautiful. And I think that is kind of a very defining phase in our careers, where we have to play these parts and we have to play them with all honesty. So, and honestly, like these are the things that are also giving us jobs now, because thankfully they're writing roles like that for women in India.
Yeah, absolutely. And then similar to that role, you played Tamina, an officer wearing a hijab in Khuda Hafiz. And that's something that is amazing because, that's such a cool picture of you with bruises and, fighting with Vidyut. Like, how was that? Like, this was also such a strong character and representation of a Middle Eastern woman. Tell us more about that.
This actually has a very, very interesting story. So Khuda Hafiz happened to me, I think towards the end of last year. I would have been in Uzbekistan today if I could turn back time. We shot for this film in Uzbekistan. And the film is about, a man looking for his wife who has been abducted in a, Arab-speaking country. And I play an officer, that's Tamina Hamid, and she helps Samir, the character that has been played by Vidyut, to bring his wife back. When they told me that I have to have hand-to-hand combat and I have to have action, I met the director. I was like, yeah, I've just done Betal, so I've done action. And he was like, no, it's not that kind of action. You have to actually have hand-to-hand combat. Like, you'll have to go through training. And I didn't know what to say to him. I was just like, oh, acha, I don't know this, you know, maybe. So I think like with a lot of roles, what happens is that you are not mentally prepared for the physicality of a role or right. what kind of prep you need to put into a role. And I had to be an Arabic speaking agent. So I had to speak Arabic in the film. I was signed literally like about a week before the film went on floor. Because there was an actress who was supposed to do this part, and then she got pregnant and she could not do the part. And then I had to, you know, then they were looking for an actor to replace her. And, you know, they asked me to audition, and I was procrastinating the audition so much because I was so scared to speak Arabic. I said, right. I can't speak Arabic. So they said, we'll send you files, you know, you have to just do the audition in that. And I realized, because when I spoke to the casting director, he told me that a lot of actors were not auditioning for that part because you had to speak Arabic.
Correct.
So he said, don't worry, you're not the only one. So I said, okay, so that makes me feel much better. But anyways, I auditioned for the part. The director liked me. And in a week, I was flying to Uzbekistan where I was going to be doing my action stunts and all my action, prep for the film. And I think I just got very lucky because Vidyut was, you know, helming the film. They brought Andy Long, who is my action director. Farooq Kabir is the director, and Andy Long is my action director in the film. Mm-hmm. And Andy is somebody who is very, he's about 28, 29. He's really young, and he's Vietnamese, but he lives in Germany, and he's a stunt director. And you know, what was lovely working with him was that because it was the first time I was doing action, there was a guy, if I had a question about a certain punch or a jab, he had an answer for it, which I think doesn't happen a lot in India. Like when you ask an action director in India a question about how would you react to a certain jab or a punch, they don't really have an answer for it. Mm-hmm. And I think what Andy did well was that he literally held our hand through the entire process of understanding action for a person who's not from a non-action space, somebody like me, you know.
Right.
I had no idea about it. So I think for me, it was very important that, you know, that he literally handheld me throughout the sequences, and he made me go through training, and he first saw what was my weak point and what was my plus point. And that's how he designed the scenes, you know, the action right. sequence. So I think it became very interesting for me to learn that kind of, you know, that kind of a way of working. Because this is something we are not taught in India. And girls don't get action sequences in India. And correct. It's very, very rare that you see women perform action in India. Because first of all, the roles are not written like that for them. Secondly, there is no one to guide them through. And I remember like Vidyut coming on set and, you know, he was like, you know, guys get a little excited when you say the word action. So if Shiv Pandit hits you, just give him one. I was like, that's good advice.
That's awesome. As an audience, like I have seen a huge difference of shift of representation of women in cinema and how they are traditionally portrayed. I mean, from my favorite film, Kabhi Khushi Kabhi Gham, where Jaya Bachchan plays this character who seldom speaks against her husband in the family with that dialogue, keh diya to bas keh diya, to portraying movies like Love Stories on Netflix and Queen, where there are women-centric films and where women openly vocalize their opinions out and loud. Even Lipstick Under My Burkha, as we were talking about previously. So being on the other side, do you think that things are evolving and how? And also, are there any stereotypes even now, I'm sure, back where you're working?
Of course there are stereotypes. And I think we are very far away from breaking stereotypes. We have started taking a step towards it, yes. And I can see now more roles, evolving for women. And I feel like I have to give a lot of credit to online platforms for that. Because I remember when I started working post-Yudh, I thought like, you know, I'm going to be like, that'll be like my breakthrough role. And that's when I'll get like the big roles because I've done my debut opposite Mr. Bachchan and, you know, the works. And that's how it works. And that's how the, you know, the cookie crumbles and everything, you know, it was all like in my head. And then suddenly there was no work because the show didn't work. You know, it was very ahead of its time. It was should have been on Netflix now. It would have done far better. But it was put on a television set. And at that time, I remember there were only TV serials and TV serials
Right.
with Bahu sagas. And I don't think I never thought that I could fit the bill there, because the kind of roles that I was being offered at that time were also like, you know, she's like this sexy one who comes and breaks the house, and I'm just like, I don't want to play those parts, yeah. I mean, I'm done. And then they never saw me as the quintessential Bahu Rani, because you know, they were like, you look too modern. And so I think there was a
Yeah.
lot of stereotyping happening even then, back then in the day. I remember like not being offered films because they were like, why don't you play this superstar's best friend, or why don't you play this actress's girlfriend? And I was like, but that's not a role, that's just like
Exactly.
somebody who's floating around next to the main actress like a sidekick. I said, I don't want to be that, thank you. So I realized that I didn't want to do that, and I lost a lot of work and lost a lot of years because of that, because I steered away from those roles. But you know, there was a time when I literally had to pick up a TV serial because I just had to make money. So I did that, and you know, I think it was 2016 is when I was offered my first web show. It was called Chukia Giri, and it was about a, you know, a boss who's literally riling up the lives of everybody in her you know, in her office. And I was still doing theater at that time, and I was not a face that people remembered or knew anything about me. And I went to Baroda for a play, because that's what I do. I do a lot of theater in India. And I remember going to Baroda, and like these six little girls, I went to buy coffee in a coffee shop, and I remember like these little girls came running to me. They're like, Rati ma'am, Rati ma'am. And I was like, you have watched it? They're like, it's on YouTube. I said, on YouTube? You know, I didn't know anything about YouTube or, you know, how the web works. And it was so wonderful to just know somebody had watched my work and recognized me, you know. I mean, for me, that was very thrilling, and it was a very proud moment. And I think that's when it started sinking in that, you know, that okay, the web is opening up for us. And that's when we started getting roles. So one role led to another role, and then that role led to another role. So I think a lot of web shows have one of the most dynamic characters written, some of the most dynamic characters written for women. And I think the film industry has taken a cue from there, and then they have started writing roles for women. It's just the way, what, you know, they all say that, you know, the audience will give you what you feed them, but you also have to make that kind of effort to be able to write those roles for women. And I think
Right.
for the longest time, the film industry did not take notice of that. And they are doing it now because they've realized that men and women alike want to watch roles which are interesting for women, and not, you know, not the Bahurani, not the Bhabhi ji, not the Mummy ji, not only
Correct.
the girl next door. You have to have feisty characters. So they are writing roles like that. But we are still very far away in films from that. Cinema in
Yeah.
India is still very far away from that.
Yeah, so like talking about some social stigmas as well, right? So which social stigmas you think that still needs to be addressed about women, which aren't represented in movies, but you know are coming or maybe should be addressed now?
I think the first and foremost, you know, that I feel like using sex is one of the most boring tools, I feel, in India. It's one of, you know, they feel that, they always feel that in India, if you write, you know, a content which is very sexually overrated, it will work. I don't
Yeah.
think so. I don't buy that. I don't think women should be only looked at as, you know, a name which becomes a household name, you know, that she can be only a girl next door. Or I feel like, you know, if a woman has to be strong, she doesn't only need to be a police officer. If a woman needs to be strong, she doesn't have to cut her hair and, you know, smoke on screen. I think those kind of social stigmas need to really go away. They need to write powerfully for women. The way they imagine the roles for men to be written, I think those kind of roles can be imagined for women. I know a lot of strong women in my life, and they are not necessarily the ones which are only portrayed on screen. You can be a very strong woman, and you could be running a household. I don't know. I always feel like women are such superhumans, especially if you come to India. You see the way women are. They manage their houses, they manage their education, they manage their husbands, they manage their children. they manage their entire world, you know, and yeah. they manage their careers. I don't know how they do it. And I think like Indian men are very dependent on their women, on women in their houses, you know, whether it's their wives or whether it's their mothers or, you know, it's, I just feel like that happens a lot. I don't know whether that happens in the world, but that happens a lot in India. And I see that. So there are a lot of stigmas attached to women, which I think can start, you know, like it doesn't need to mount up so much. Mm-hmm. And I really want that to happen. I want them to write interesting roles for women. I want them to write roles at par with men. Give them the roles, you know. And I always say this, and I've not said this in this interview, but I've said this in, I think, 100 interviews. They'll make a film, like a film on cricket, and then they'll put, like, say, 12 actors in that film. Then they'll make a film on football, and then they'll again put 12 male actors there, you know, 12, 15, whatever they want to cast. Then they'll make a film on hockey, and then they'll again make it for men. And I'm like, what about the women? Do you realize how many actresses in India would, like, cut an arm for a good role? Write those roles. Don't pit a woman against a woman because there is that one role, you know. Write the roles for the women and give them equal opportunities, and you'll be surprised as to how many actresses in India can, you know, outdo you. Really, we can outdo the boys.
I have no doubt about that. So, you know, you're so confident in your own skin, and there are a lot of women, men, and even like underrepresented groups that are watching us today. Is there any advice you want to give them? Like, I'm sure, you know, there are so many things going on in the world right now, but just in terms of just being confident in your own skin, going out there and shining and, you know, all of that. So do you have any advice for people out there who relate to your characters that you have portrayed, and also just, you know, look up to you?
Wow. Okay. Long one. But, you know, Gautami, the one thing that I think I have relied a lot upon is training. I rely heavily on training, and I've been a trained actor. I had nothing. I still have nothing. And I feel like I compare myself to a fakir. I'm a fakir, and I'll always be a fakir. I'll never ever think that I'm very successful, because I think that I always have windows to, like, there's a window to learn.
Yeah.
There's a window to grow. There's a window to progress. And the minute, you know, there's a saying by a very well-known theater artist. He's somebody we all look up to. His name is, Satyadev Dubey. So we call him Dubeji very pyar, like very fondly. And Dubeji is somebody who's been a very integral part of my growing. You know, he's a very big theater director, actor, everybody. He's been a guru to Naseer Sahab, to Ratna Pathak, to everybody. Like, you say, like, you take his name and everybody will be able to, understand what I'm saying. So I remember Dubeji once saying to all of us, you know, he said, satisfaction is death. And that is something that I think I go by with, like, my life revolves around that those three words. Because the minute you are satisfied, you'll kill the artist inside you. So never think that I have achieved everything I want and I have got everything, because I think every show is a learning. Every character is a learning. Every character is an empathy. Every time I play a character, I learn so much more about another person and about their life. And I go, like, you know, because I've done the research on that person, and I'm just like, my God, like, you know, we think that our lives are like this. Like, look at the lives of people that we are actually playing. Look at those lives. So, you know, it makes you very empathetic towards other people. So I think my job really helps me do that. So with Leela, I learned what is the life of a woman who's stifled in Bhopal, you know, a beautician. With Alu, I learned, you know, what is the life of a woman in, you know, in as a soldier. With Tamina, I learned what is the life of, you know, an Arabic speaking, hijab wearing, you know, agent in an Arabic nation. I think with every role you learn. So there is so much to learn. So I feel like anybody who feels they are falling short of something, just rely upon training. And it really is important that, you know, that you train, because how can you become a doctor if you're not studying medicine? Or how do you become, I don't know, how would you work in Google if you were not an engineer, you know?
Right.
And I just feel like, you know, we take it so lightly sometimes. We just feel that, no, we don't need that kind of training. I can just come to Bombay and become a star. I mean, yes, you need to have that kind of kismat. I feel like you need that kind of kismat, but you also need training. You need training. And to be confident, you need to be able to say, hey, I know my job. That's one thing I know. So do not argue there. I know what I'm doing. So then, you know, and that's the reason why I think most of us are getting hired, because we know what we want and we know how to go about with our jobs. So that's where confidence comes in.
I so agree with that. Like, I mean, when I joined Google as well, like we have, this is a very famous term here called as imposter syndrome. You always doubt your abilities, you know, based on other people. You always think you're not good enough. But when I like trained myself and really got used to doing the same thing again and again, I was confident within, and then automatically it's shown, right? Like, okay, you know your job, you know what is to be done. And yeah, that is such a great advice, that train in things you think you're short of, and then eventually you'll be confident and people will look at you that way. So that's an amazing advice. We have one question from the audience. Let's see, Sophia. Sophia asks that, love the message around building the new age of superheroines. Given the theme, which advice would you give to your younger self?
I think the one advice I think I'd give to my younger self would be, take yourself seriously. I don't think I took myself very seriously when I was growing up. I think I took myself very lightly. I thought, like, you know, others' opinions was very integral to my life. In hindsight, now that I think about it, I don't think that matters. I should have never taken advice from so many people. I should have just paid attention to, you know, what my gut feeling says. And I should have not, you know, when somebody, I remember people telling me that you're not heroine material. And a lot of people telling me that, you know, that tumhara kuch nahi hoga, which is basically like, you'll not get anywhere. You won't, with that attitude, you'll not be anywhere. And I remember feeling horrible and dejected about the entire process of, like, you know, oh my God, like, is that true? Like, you know, if I'm so strong headed, I'll not get anywhere. And now when I look back, those people are actually unemployed. And I'm like, oh, it's fine, you know, I listened to my gut feeling. But I think the one advice I would give my younger self would be that, don't listen to what people have to say. Listen to yourself, listen to your family. It's very important. Your parents believe in you the most, and your siblings believe in you the most. So just listen to them, you know, they are the ones who have the right advice.
Right. And also to the audience watching, if you have any questions, please, you know, put it in the comments chat, and then Ahana is happy to answer any of them. So I'll move on to my next questions. I am very excited about any of your upcoming projects. So anything you can share with us that you're working on in terms of, you know, playing, continuing to play amazing characters on the screen.
I'm actually quite thrilled. There is a show called Call My Agent, which is a Netflix series. And I'm playing, it's a French series. And the Indian version is now being shot in India. And it's being directed by Shahid Ali, who's a very celebrated director in India. And I play the role of Amal, which is actually Andrea's character. So it's a story about four agents, and we handle the work of all the celebrities, the Bollywood celebrities. So I'm playing a talent management agent in the series.
Nice.
And it's a very different part. It's a very interesting part. And we are currently filming that in Bombay. And I'm very excited to play this role, because I've never played a role like this. And you know, I'm excited and thrilled to see what the reactions of the public is, or the audience is going to be once the show comes out, I think next year. So that's what I'm currently filming.
That's awesome. As times are changing now during pandemic, how has your work shifted during this time? Are you liking, I mean, in the beginning, everything was digital, online, like we are working from our homes till next year now. So how has the experience been for you? How do you feel about working from home? Or even now, like things are changing, getting back to normal step by step. But how is work? How work looks like for you?
It's actually been quite interesting. I was working like a machine for the last few years. I literally like lived out of my suitcase because my parents never saw me home. I used to finish one project and then run to another city or another country and do another project and then run somewhere else. And then, so the lockdown actually was quite a boon because I got to spend so much time at home, paying attention to my health, paying attention to my family, paying attention to my nephew who's growing up. He's 4 now, and he's very attached to me. He literally does everything with me, eats his food with me, and works out with me, and plays with me. So there's a lot of we are very attached. So I think I got to spend so much time with him, which I never got to see him while he was growing up. And I think I just in general realized that for me, my health was integral. It was key. And meditation and praying was is eternal. It's something that I have completely ignored all my life. I started meditating, I started praying to God, I started saying thanks, something that I had completely, I think, stopped doing or taking it for granted. It has really calmed me down, the lockdown. Then once the lockdown for us, I think in July, it kind of ended for us. In August, I got my first show. I already completed a show called Sandwich. It's a sitcom that we shot in Bombay. We shot in a studio in Bombay. It's a show directed by Rohan Sippy. And it's again got a fantastic cast. It's got 6 theater actors. We shot it exactly like a play. And we were so scared in the beginning because we had Zoom meetings, and we had. So for actors, it's very difficult to do Zoom meetings and understand the virtual space because our work involves physically being there. Because we can shoot a lot of videos from home, but by the end of the day, the sheer joy of being on set, the sheer joy of being in front of camera is just a joy you can't take away from any actor. I think everybody in our industry was dying to get back to set. And I remember the first time we met, we were also worried. We were not coming close to each other. We weren't hugging each other. And I think after 1 week, there was no social distancing. Although we took a lot of
Oh,
precautions, there was COVID test done before we started shooting.
God.
Everybody's test was done. But you can't control COVID because there's nothing you can do about, if somebody gets affected. And the one thing that I think that all the actors and the crew and the cast unanimously decided was that even if somebody's COVID positive, we'll all huddle together and we'll finish the project. We will not let the project get, disturbed. Even if anybody, unless if it's a cast member, then of course there's no other option but to take a 14-day quarantine. But if it's not the cast member, then if somebody can be replaced, we'll just replace them and the show will go on because a lot of livelihood depends upon us being healthy and us being able to work every day. Because if I don't work, there's a whole staff that doesn't work. If I don't work, the lightmen, the set, the setting boys, there's a crew of 100 people who don't get employed and their families get affected. So we need to, the show must go on. So for us, it was initially very difficult. And then I think another week, and then we were like, you know what? We need to go back to normal ways of working. So we went back to our normal way of working. And now I'm on my second show. Again, we started with a COVID test, and everybody has to share vanity, everybody has to share space, we can't wear masks while we're shooting. So there's a lot of things that actors need to be really careful about. I think the only thing that I'm really careful about is when I come home, I don't sit with my parents. I kind of isolate myself. That's something that I do, and I think most actors do that, they don't spend time with their family. So although we're in the same house, but we maintain distance with our family. But I think the one thing that I really like, for me, my COVID test has been my runs. So this is something I started doing during the lockdown. I started running, say about 5 kilometers. Then I started running 7 kilometers. Then I started running 10. And now I run like a 13 kilometer, you know, easily in about an hour. And I've tanned entirely. I've become like 5 shades darker than what I am because I absolutely enjoyed the sun. I enjoyed Bombay. It was like a playground for me. The roads were clean. The roads were empty. There was no one on the road. I used to go cycling till Haji Ali sometimes and come back. I used to go running on the road. You know, nobody would like there would be there to stop you. And I think it was so fantastic. And for me, like I've been saying that to everybody, that's my COVID test. If I can run 13 kilometers, I'm fine, you know.
Correct. Yeah. And seeing your morning selfies every time, like, I'm like, okay, like I need to get up and do something. So yeah, that is been very encouraging for me. I'm like, okay, I have to at least do a
30. That is early, Gautami.
I know.
Every time you try to talk to me, I'm just like, Gautami, I'm so sleepy. Gautami, I'm going to talk to you tomorrow. I can't.
And then your morning, I'm like, okay, now I have to sleep.
I know.
Okay, so we have one more question from the audience. We'll probably bring that up as well. So Forum says, hi Forum, I'm loving this interview. My question is, how would an actor so emotionally attached to the character detach from it? Does it affect an actor's health in long run, imbibing and emoting a character?
That's a nice question, Forum. Thank you. Well, I think there's a show that I've recently done. It's called Marzi. It's a remake of, again, a BBC series called Liar. And we shot for that in Shimla last year. It was a very emotionally draining show for me, quite honestly. The show was based on a girl who gets, you know, the story is about a girl who gets raped on a date. And then she's trying to prove to the entire world that has actually happened, as opposed to the man who's saying that I didn't do anything. So it was like a he says, she says story. And for me, it was a very emotionally draining show. And I must say, I was very unpleasant on set when I was shooting for the entire series. There were times when I used to not talk to anybody. Nobody was allowed to come into my vanity because the scenes were so heavy on emotions that I could not, you know, giggle and laugh and chit chat on set, which is what actually happens sometimes, you know, because you are with so many people and, you know, you need to keep the set happy and it needs to be very cordial. So there were times when I would just not talk to anyone and I would not acknowledge anybody and I would just not like look at anybody because I was so involved with my scenes and I knew that I had to deliver the performance, you know, in that time limit that I had to finish filming. So it took me about a week to detach. After I stopped the show, when the show finished filming, I took about a week to detach myself from that space. But did it affect my health? No, I don't think so. I eat and I take care of my health very, you know, I'm very, very particular about my health and I'm very careful about my food because you have to be careful about, you know, who you are. Because if I don't take care of myself, then there is, as I said, that there are like 100 people depending on me for their employment. You know, that's my job to make sure that I stay healthy so that I don't take a day off from work so that it doesn't affect somebody else's livelihood. So we have to be very, very careful about how we are or how healthy we are as actors to be making sure that, you know, that it doesn't affect the livelihood of anybody else. So did it affect my health? No, it didn't. But yes, I think like a lot of emotional beating can take place. But again, you know, the wonderful thing about being an artist is I feel that, you know, that I can vent out my anger. When I'm angry about something, you know, there's so many times when I have to do a scene and I can always visit an emotional memory, you know, something that has affected me in the past, something that has hurt me, something that has really been difficult for me. And, you know, I can get through it because I can cry and I can vent out my emotions, as opposed to lots of times when, you know, on a normal day-to-day basis, a lot of people cannot do that in their day-to-day lives. So I think I feel very blessed as an actor, as an artist, that, you know, I have a window to vent out my emotions, and I can do that quite well through my work.
Right. And congratulations for winning the Best Actress Award for Mercy as well at the Asian Academy Awards.
Thank you.
You have made everyone proud. How was that experience in terms of representing such a strong, again, such a strong character in Marzi, right? And in terms of winning it, like from playing it to actually winning it, and you have gotten so many well wishes and congratulations from everyone across the industry. So, do you want to kind of share your experience in terms of winning that award and playing that character?
Yeah, I think it was very it was really nice. I didn't know what it was. I was shooting for Call My Agent, and I remember like my producer constantly calling me, and I was like, listen, I'm in the middle of a shot, I can't talk, So I came down to my vanity to change to the next scene, and I called him up. I said, yeah, what happened? And then he was like, you won an award. I said, what award? And he's like, you won the best actress for at the Asian Academy. And I was like, what is this award? And then he was like, okay, let somebody from the Woot team call you, because even I'm very confused. I don't know what's happening. And I was like, okay, I'm very confused. So it was really funny because nobody knew what was happening. And then the head of the Woot from the Woot team, she called me up, Aparna, and she was like, this is an equivalent to the Emmys in Asia, because the Emmys cannot enter Asia, so this is an equivalent to that. And I was like, oh, is it? And then I was like, it just like sunk me, like it took me like about five minutes to sink in that I had won this award. And Manoj Bajpayee had won the award for Family Man from the men's category, from the actors category. And I just like stepped out of my vanity. I didn't know who to tell this to, because I was just like, who do I tell this to? Like, who do I tell? So I was like, I just met like some random guy for production. I hugged him and I said, I just won an award.
Oh.
He was just looking at me. He was like, okay, congrats. And I was like, thanks.
That's honor for you
Yeah,
guys.
and I was so confused, and I called up my parents, and then they were like, oh, very good, very good. And I don't think till then also it kind of sunk in. And it took me like a night to like figure out that I actually won that award. And I was like, oh, I did. Okay, So I think it was pretty cool, because from India, like it was really nice, because I think there were very good parts and there were very interesting roles that a lot of actresses have portrayed on screen in this year. And I think to be able to win amongst all of them was really a big deal for me.
Yeah, congratulations. We
And
are all super proud of you.
I was just like, yes!
Yes. So you put it, and I was like, oh wow, that is amazing. And then I was not aware of what Asian Academy Awards is, and then I read about it, and then there are very few people who have actually won this, and I was like, that's my friend. So that's amazing. Well, I am done with all my questions, and I think in terms of the audience as well, we are getting amazing comments. Everyone's loving it. Love struck smiley. So keep all the love coming, guys.
Oh my God, you've done so well.
it was so good talking to you, Ahana. Like, I am grinning ear to ear. My cheeks are actually paining. Like, I have just smiled through this entire interview.
Sweet.
But thank you for your time. I know you have a crazy busy schedule, and like I know that firsthand now. So thank you for investing your few minutes and chatting with us at
Oh,
Talks in
no, of
Google.
course.
And keep shining, keep encouraging people by playing the characters you have always played. And stay safe and take care.
You stay safe. Come back to Bombay very soon, or else I'll have to bring your chakli and gujia to Bo
Yes, for
Bombay.
yeah, I will. Hopefully, if flights start and everything, I will definitely come in, and we'll catch up soon. For everyone joining in, thank you so much for tuning live with us, and take care. Please wear masks and stay safe.
Yeah. Stay safe. Maintain social distance. Don't huddle up. I should not be saying these things considering I'm on shoot.
But you're taking all the COVID tests, so you're doing all the right thing what is required. The show must go on, right?
The show must go on. You're right.
All right, and everyone, happy Diwali once again.
Happy Diwali! Put on lots of weight! Okay. Namaste, Adam. See you guys. Thanks, Gautami.